Hey, it's George Chuang. Let's continue our study through the book of Mark, starting in chapter 6. Then he went out from there and came to his own country, and his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath had come, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? And what wisdom is this which is given to him, that such mighty works are performed by his hands? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" So they were offended at him. Jesus was known as the son of Mary, probably because Joseph had died when he was young. And being the oldest son in the family, he likely helped provide for the family. He was a carpenter. So if you needed your wooden chair fixed or a table fixed or some woodwork done, you went to Jesus. He wasn't trained in the scriptures like the scribes and Pharisees were, but he somehow just knew the scriptures without studying them. That's why the Jews marveled, saying, "How does this man know letters, having never studied?" Jesus is a carpenter. He's not a scholar. So Jesus was in his country among people he grew up with. That's just Jesus. He fixed my front door 5 years ago. I remember seeing him running around here with his little brothers when they were all kids. So they were offended at him because now he's saying he's a scholar, a teacher, and he's making disciples. But the guy's a carpenter. Think of it this way. Some kid graduates high school. He works full-time at the supermarket now. You've seen him working there ever since, and he's 30 years old now. Suddenly, he's now claiming to be an expert on economic policy, and he has a large crowd of people following him, wanting his financial advice. He opens his mouth and he sounds incredibly smart and wise. But you look at him and say, "That's Joe. He's been bagging my groceries and ringing me up at the register since he graduated high school. What does he know?" So you get offended at him because that's not who he is. He's not an expert. Why do people even listen to him? Sometimes the hardest people to reach are the people you grew up with because they've known you since you were a kid. But what they don't know is how God has transformed you. God raises you up. You are a new creation and someone totally different. But they still see you as George, Joe, Sam, Bob. We know you. And they may get offended, especially if it's completely different from what you used to be and what you were known to be. Jesus was a carpenter. Now he's a Bible expert and a teacher of the law, making disciples. Verse 4. But Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives, and in his own house." And that is true. In his own country refers to the area you grew up, your hometown, not the entire country. People who didn't know you before only know you as what you are now. If God raises you up to be a prophet, all those who meet you now only know you as a prophet. Whereas people you grew up with may know you as the jokester, the computer nerd, or whatever. Verse 5. Now he could do no mighty work there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. Then he went about the villages in a circuit teaching. Your faith or unbelief does affect what Jesus can do in your life. It's true, God can do miracles without your faith. When Lazarus was raised from the dead, the miracle wasn't dependent on Lazarus's faith. He was dead. He had no faith. Lazarus was just a dead body rotting away. His soul was already somewhere else since he had already been dead for 4 days. Jesus raises him from the dead and he pops back into his body, wondering what happened. Looks like he was just brought back to life. However, unbelief can cause God to not work in your life. When you pray, you have to believe that you receive it. As Jesus taught us in Mark 11:24, "Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." Now, why don't we receive everything we ask for? This only works when you are in tune with the Holy Spirit and you are asking for things God desires to do and give you. If you pray amiss, you're not going to get anything. James 4:3, "You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures." If you ask for selfish pleasures, you're not going to receive it. But when you are in tune with the Holy Spirit and you ask enough with faith, you'll get results. And why with faith? In Hebrews 11:6, "And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him." Believe God is good, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. It's the same with people. If you say to me, "George, I think you're a terrible human being, but can you help me out?" I'll say, "You think I'm a terrible person, but you want my help. Why would a terrible person even help you?" Your asking me for help is a contradiction of what you believe me to be. You think I'm a terrible person who doesn't help people, so you come to me for help. This doesn't make any sense. "I knew you wouldn't help me." This is the attitude some people have with God. They think God owes them something. They have misconceptions about who God is. They have evil thoughts about God. Then they want God to give them something or help them. Listen, God doesn't owe you anything. Approach God as a good father who gives good gifts to undeserving children. Align yourself with the desires of the Holy Spirit and then pray for those things. I bet there is so much good that God wants to give us, but we don't pray for it. Why doesn't God just give it? Because when you pray, you are developing relationship with him. You are growing stronger spiritually. Then when you receive it, you will know how to use it or handle it. And you will be in tune with God because you have been communing with him and praying. Verse 7, "And he called the 12 to himself and began to send them out two by two and gave them power over unclean spirits. He commanded them to take nothing for the journey except a staff, no bag, no bread, no copper in their money belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics." Jesus was training them to have faith. Later, he would tell them to bring a money bag, knapsack, and sword. Here's what God wants you to learn. God is in charge. He can provide everything for you, so you lack nothing. He can make the journey easy, where you don't need a bag, bread, or money. But guess what? Later, it's going to get tough. You're going to need a money bag, bread, and provisions. You're going to need to plan and prepare. You may go hungry. You may get beaten. But God is just as much in charge and in control when things are easy as when things are tough and hard. Jesus can say, "Take nothing. Everything's going to be easy." And he can say, "Plan and prepare. Things are going to get rough." Why doesn't God make it easy all the time? Because easy doesn't build character. Easy doesn't get you eternal rewards in heaven. Verse 10. "Also, he said to them, 'In whatever place you enter a house, stay there till you depart from that place. And whoever will not receive you nor hear you, when you depart from there, shake off the dust under your feet as a testimony against them. Assuredly, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city." Your job is not to make people hear you. Some misguided Christians think they must force people to hear the gospel so they can make a decision. Jesus said, if they won't hear you, just move on. No need to be an obnoxious Christian trying to get in people's faces. Some people are just not heavenly minded. They could care less about the things of God. Let them be and move on. However, the judgment will be very severe for those who are godless and don't care about their eternity. It will be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. That tells us there are different levels of judgment. But let me share something I've noticed. Some people say, nobody wants to hear the gospel. I share with them and they don't want to hear me. So I shake off the dust off my feet and tell them they're going to hell. Well, let me just be completely honest with you. It's not that people don't want to hear the gospel. The real reason nobody wants to listen to you is because you are a terrible human being. There, I said it. A person who is filled with the love of God and the Holy Spirit can sit in the marketplace like the Apostle Paul and reason with people. Sure, you'll get those who blow you off because they are like Esau and care not for spiritual things. But if you are a genuine, loving, and kind person, most people would enjoy carrying on a conversation with you and reason with you. Some atheists can be really nice people, and some are terrible human beings. The same goes for Christians. Well, to be more accurate, they profess to know Christ. Whether they are real or not, only God knows for certain. But I would not want to be their friends. Unfortunately, one bad Christian can leave a bad taste in the mouth of non-believers. They have a bad impression of Christians all because they knew a person who was very vocal about their faith and they were a terrible human being. As troubling as that is, it does give me an opportunity to undo their works by being an incredible, loving person who loves Jesus. Verse 12. So they went out and preached that people should repent, and they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. I believe the oil is symbolic and works as a point of contact to activate a person's faith. I don't believe there are formulas to follow where you can get God to heal. Sometimes Jesus spat. Sometimes he just spoke. You can't put God in a box and write formulas for how to get God to heal. Verse 14. Now King Herod heard of him, for his name had become well known. And he said, John the Baptist is risen from the dead, and therefore these powers are at work in him. Others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is the prophet, or like one of the prophets. But when Herod heard, he said, this is John, whom I beheaded. He has been raised from the dead. For Herod himself had sent and laid hold of John and bound him in prison for the sake of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, for he had married her. Because John had said to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. Herod here is Herod Antipas. He was the son of Herod the Great. Herod the Great was the one who ordered the killing of all children under 2 years of age when Jesus was born. He was a paranoid little man, about 4'9". That's about 145 centimeters for those of you on the metric system. To make up for his smallness, he built great big monuments. Herod the Great was crazy and paranoid. His family was really messed up. I won't go into all the details, but he married a total of 10 wives and had many sons. Some of his wives and sons he executed, and the saying went out that it was safer to be Herod's pig than his son. So back to our story. Herod here is Herod Antipas, and he married his brother Philip's wife. Philip is Herod's half-brother. Now Herodias is the niece of Philip and Herod. Her father was one of the executed sons of Herod the Great. So Herodias first married her uncle Philip. This Philip, there's more than one, was not a ruler, but just a wealthy merchant. Herodias, however, wanted power, was ambitious, and was scheming. So she married her other uncle, Herod Antipas, since he fell in love with her. And John spoke out against this. "You guys are all messed up. You can't have your brother's wife. What's wrong with you?" Verse 19. Therefore, Herodias held it against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a just and holy man, and he protected him. And when he heard him, he did many things and heard him gladly. So Herodias wanted John dead, but Herod liked listening to John, made him feel good, made some changes, but didn't really do as John said. Then an opportune day came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a feast for his nobles, the high officers and the chief men of Galilee. And when Herodias' daughter herself came in and danced and pleased Herod and those who sat with him, the king said to the girl, "Ask me whatever you want, and I will give it to you." The dance here is very likely a provocative and seductive dance. That just goes to show what kind of mother Herodias was to let her daughter dance this way before all these men. He also swore to her, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you, up to half my kingdom." So she went out and said to her mother, "What shall I ask?" And she said, "The head of John the Baptist." Immediately she came in with haste to the king and asked, saying, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." And the king was exceedingly sorry. Yet because of the oaths and because of those who sat with him, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent an executioner and commanded his head to be brought. And he went and beheaded him in prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. And the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard of it, they came and took away his corpse and laid it in a tomb. Now there's something here that I don't want you to miss, and that's the Elijah-Jezebel paradigm. In the time of Elijah, there was a woman named Jezebel who wanted Elijah dead. Jezebel was a very ungodly woman with influence and power. Now Elijah is to precede the coming of Messiah. Whenever Jesus comes, Elijah is to come first and prepare the way. Jesus is coming twice. He came once, 2,000 years ago, and he's coming again. The first Elijah to prepare the way was John the Baptist. The purpose of this Elijah forerunner is to be a sign of the coming Messiah and prepare the way for Christ, the king. Now, when Elijah appears, expect a Jezebel to be on the scene. So the Jezebel in the time of John the Baptist was Herodias. She was only able to kill John the Baptist because Jesus was going to be executed. John had to be a sign of the coming Messiah. And that sign was Messiah would be executed. Now, when Jesus comes this second time, another Elijah forerunner will be sent out, and expect there to be another Jezebel on the scene. In fact, the Jezebel spirit is already present and working. Women's morals and values just took a plunge in this generation. But will Jezebel prevail against God's coming Elijah this time around, like she did against John the Baptist? The answer is no, because this coming Elijah is a sign of the coming Messiah. And Jesus isn't coming back to be mocked, beaten, and executed. Jesus is coming back as a conqueror. He's coming back to reign and establish righteousness on earth. So expect the coming Elijah to be a conqueror and a victor. He will not be defeated because he must be a sign of the coming Messiah. So that's very good news. Verse 30. Then the apostles gathered to Jesus and told him all things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And he said to them, "Come aside by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while." For there were many coming and going, and they did not even have time to eat. So they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves. But the multitude saw them departing, and many knew him, and ran there on foot from all the cities. They arrived before them and came together to him. And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them, because they were like sheep not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. They were so busy they didn't even have time to eat. You can always check a minister's heart by his actions. Some ministers act like they're movie stars from Hollywood. After they do their thing on stage, "It's break time. It's my lunch break. Book signing starts at 3. I don't want to be interrupted until then." But Jesus has so much compassion for the people. He sees all those people and they have no shepherd to lead them. So he starts teaching them instead of taking a break. They didn't even have time to eat. And Jesus sees all these people and he loves them. So he just begins teaching them many things. And how good it must have been to just sit there listening to Jesus speak. Verse 35. When the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and already the hour is late. Send them away that they may go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat." If we were there, we'd probably forget to eat. Listening to Jesus is just so good to the soul. Verse 37. But he answered and said to them, "You give them something to eat." And they said to him, "Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat?" But he said to them, "How many loaves do you have? Go and see." And when they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then he commanded them to make them all sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in ranks, in hundreds and in fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven, blessed and broke the loaves, and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the 2 fish he divided among them all. So they all ate and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fish. Now those who had eaten the loaves were about 5,000 men. I always wondered how this event happened. Did the bread and fish simply appear out of thin air? Or did they have baskets and the food just multiplied? Now I want to point out that only God can create out of nothing. There are ministers in the church that say Satan has that power. They say Satan performs healings and miracles. God doesn't do that anymore. These ministers are of the devil. When Jesus cast out demons, some Pharisees said it was by the power of the devil. And I'm sure these Pharisees also believed the healings and miracles were done by Satan. They're definitely not going to say the casting out of demons is by the devil, but the healing is by the power of God. No, I'm sure they attribute it all to the devil. But those who are of the Lord, such as Nicodemus, will say, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." This is what you need to know. The servants of Satan always attribute to Satan the power and works of God. They always claim for Satan the things that belong to God. This is one way to uncover servants of Satan. They always claim for Satan or attribute to Satan the things that God is doing or things that belong to God. For example, I like having lightning as my logo. Lightning and thunder. In the Bible, lightning and thunder is always before the throne of God, symbolizing God's power. James and John were called sons of thunder. That is, thunder-like zeal. Sons of thunder wasn't about having bad tempers. as some ministers teach. Jesus wasn't trying to demoralize or insult his disciples on their shortcomings. It was an encouragement to them. But some people have said, "I'm using Satan's sign. Lightning is the sign of Satan. It's Satan's power." And they'll quote Luke 10:18. "And he said to them, 'I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven.'" They say, "See how Satan is lightning?" Then you go back and read that passage. Read one verse before it, Luke 10:17. "Then the 70 returned with joy, saying, 'Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name.'" Bam! These demons got nothing on us. They obey us in your name, Jesus. And that's when Jesus said, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." Meaning, that's how fast he fell from heaven and was defeated. Jesus goes on in the next verse, "Behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." Satan is completely defeated. "I give you authority over all the power of the enemy." That's how fast Satan fell and was defeated. "I saw him fall like lightning. Bam! His power's gone." He fell like lightning. Not that he is like lightning, but the servants of Satan twist the scriptures and take it out of context so they can attribute this power to him and say, "This is his sign." And they do manage to deceive some. The Pharisees did the same thing, and Jesus said their father was the devil. So don't be surprised that ministers of Satan attribute to Satan the things that belong to God. Satan is in the church. Some are deceived and they follow these pastors. But the will of the Lord be done. These people follow them for a reason. The Pharisees also had a large following, and they managed to get Jesus crucified by stirring up the crowds. But those who truly love the Lord with a pure heart and genuine love will not be deceived. I don't believe God will allow you to be deceived. I've noticed those who follow ministers of Satan don't bear good fruit. They are often terrible human beings, full of hate, just bad fruit. Verse 45. "Immediately he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he sent the multitude away. And when he had sent them away, he departed to the mountain to pray." This is such an important lesson. After ministering all day, Jesus says, "I need to pray." And he departs so he can pray alone. If Jesus thought it's so important to pray, how much more do we need it? He is our perfect example. Let us try our best to not neglect prayer. Sometimes I just want to sit and relax after a tiring day. But for Jesus, praying is recharging. If you're a minister, prayer and the Word of God should be your number one priority. Jesus was a man of prayer. The apostles focused on prayer and the Word of God. The apostle said in Acts 6:4, "But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word." Unfortunately, for many pastors, a lot of their time is spent on administration and paperwork. It's tragic. It needs to be done, but if possible, it's best to delegate those tasks to someone else. When I was still in Bible college, a pastor told me being a pastor was not what he thought at all, because there's so much administrative stuff that needs to be done. A lot of paperwork and stuff to do. Not what he imagined at all. Totally different from, say, house churches in China. A house church pastor will likely pray all day while studying the Word of God, then go preach the Word of God from village to village. Something more in line with the Book of Acts. But a church in the US is bound by all the legal stuff that needs to be done. And church finances are limited, so most of the work needs to be done by the pastor. very unfortunate. I bet we'd see God do so much more if we prayed like the early church. Verse 47. Now when evening came, the boat was in the middle of the sea, and he was alone on the land. Then he saw them straining at rowing, for the wind was against them. Now about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking on the sea, and would have passed them by. The fourth watch is the time between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. So they're straining at rowing, and the wind is blowing against them. Then Jesus casually walks by. Hey guys, it's tough rowing against the wind, isn't it? Well, I'm just gonna keep on going. Jesus must have a great sense of humor. Unless he was walking and deep in thought, and then suddenly realized, oh, there they are. And when they saw him walking on the sea, they supposed it was a ghost and cried out, for they all saw him and were troubled. But immediately he talked with them and said to them, be of good cheer, it is I, do not be afraid. Then he went up into the boat to them, and the wind ceased, and they were greatly amazed in themselves beyond measure and marveled, for they had not understood about the loaves, because their heart was hardened. What kind of faith does it take to say, I'm going to walk on the sea and go to the other side? Some of the things Jesus did is really mind-boggling when you think about it. Unless God specifically told Jesus to walk across and Jesus simply obeyed. But in Matthew's gospel, Jesus did tell Peter to walk on the water. So maybe it was simply faith and his desire to walk on the water. I wish I could get into the Lord's head and be taught by him to have his faith and his outlook on life and everything else. What would that be like? Amazing. Verse 53, when they had crossed over, they came to the land of Gennesaret and anchored there. And when they came out of the boat, immediately the people recognized him, ran through that whole surrounding region, and began to carry about on beds those who were sick to wherever they heard he was. Wherever he entered, into villages, cities, or the country, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and begged him that they might just touch the hem of his garment, and as many as touched him were made well. No doubt the story of the woman who had the flow of blood, who touched him and was healed, had spread. So many simply just wanted to touch him. Now, I understand that a person's faith is important in receiving healing. Touching him releases their faith. But I also understand that power went out of Jesus, as we studied in the last chapter. So there is something else going on. It's likely a combination of a person's faith and the power of God being present to heal. It does tell us in Luke 5:17, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Also, the apostles prayed that God would stretch out his hand to heal, and that signs and wonders would be done through the name of Jesus. So it must be a combination of faith and God's power being present to heal. If God's power is present, but the people don't have faith, then it'll be as we read in the beginning of this chapter, he could do no mighty work there, because of their unbelief. I pray you've been blessed as we study the Word of God together. May God bring you closer to Him as we walk with Him daily. And until next time, the Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make His face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee, the Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. God bless you guys. Bye-bye.